Hey yo, from the Kingdom of Ohio, you are listening to O'Culture, and if you thought I was crazy for equating the reality we live in to a pro wrestling spectacle, well, you will need to think again, my friend. I am your host, Ryan Peverly. Welcome to the show, thanks for being here. And my oh my, what a guest we have this time around. Gary Lachman has brought his imagination to the house party, and we'll be chatting a bit about two of his recent books, Lost Knowledge of the Imagination, and Dark Star Rising, Magic and Power in the Age of Trump. Those two books are just a couple of the now more than 20 Gary has authored on topics ranging from the evolution of consciousness to literary suicides, popular culture, and the history of the occult. Gary is one of, and maybe the preeminent, esoteric scholar in the game today. Some of you know him as Gary Valentine from the band Blondie. Others know him as a biographer of names like Aleister Crowley, Rudolf Steiner, Carl Jung, Helena Blavatsky, and Colin Wilson. And after this chat, all of you will know him as Woke AF, because Gary is going to illuminate the dark recesses of the socio-political imagination, which features a pro wrestling Hall of Famer as the current sitting U.S. president, a team of Russian propagandists creating this wonderful postmodern theater, and a cartoon frog that's been passed around so much on the internet, you'd think its name was Stormy. Enjoy. All right, so Gary Lachman, thanks for your time, yeah. Man. I really appreciate you being here.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for having me on.
Absolutely, man. Well, we have a lot to talk about, but before we get into that, give us like the brief, you know, minute or less version of who you are and where you came from for those who aren't aware of you and your work.
All right. Well, my name is Gary Lachman, as you've already said, and I write about the Western esoteric tradition. It's also known as the Western Hermetic tradition or the occult tradition. And I got interested in that sort of thing, this sort of thing, many, many years ago when I was a musician working in New York in the sort of mid-1970s. And I was playing in the then practically unknown but soon to be rather well-known band Blondie. But while I was playing bass guitar there and living in a rundown loft space on the Bowery, I came across a book by a British writer named Colin Wilson, and it just was called The Occult. And I wasn't particularly interested in anything to do with the occult prior to that, aside from sort of horror films or Lovecraft, you know, weird tales sort of fiction, that kind of thing. But where I was living at the time in this loft space, Chris Stein, who was the guitarist, and Debbie Harry, the singer, of course, they had a kind of kitschy, you know, fun kind of pop interest in, you know, occult kind of stuff with some, you know, pentagrams here and there and voodoo dolls and vampire things and stuff like that. But someone else in the building was this artist who was very interested in Aleister Crowley, the British magician, the most, you know, the most famous magician or infamous magician of the 20th century. And he had a pack of his Crowley's Thoth Tarot deck, which at the time was still, this is 1975, at the time it was still relatively rare. And he used to do these impromptu readings of the tarot cards, and then he did these paintings based on the tarot trumps. And I just got very interested in it. And I started reading Wilson's book, and I was completely sort of bowled over by it. And what made it so fascinating for me was that it wasn't just a book of spells or, you know, ghost stories or things of that sort. He approached it from the philosophical perspective, and because he had written about existentialism before. And I subsequently became quite a devotee of his work. And in the end, I wrote a book about him. It came out a couple of years ago. He died in 2013. But in any case, I just became engrossed in the occult and the paranormal, and all this stuff was very, very popular at that time, and there was a lot of books available in New York where I was living at the time, and so on. So it started out just sort of naive enthusiasm, but over the years I gradually became more interested in its history and its relation to culture at large. And some years later, after I retired from rock and roll and went on to other things, in the early 90s, I started writing book reviews and articles about this sort of thing. And from then until now, I've just been writing books. So I think I've racked up about 21 of them right now. So yeah, I've been pretty active at it.
I would say so, man. Yeah. And I guess you're here because two recent books have been published in the last few months. And I don't know if you are aware of this, but I title all of my episodes as if they're like a chapter in a story. And the title I'm going to give this one is the same title as one of my favorite songs, King Crimson's 21st Century Schizoid Man. When did you first hear that song, and why is it such a good companion piece for your two most recent books?
Well, I heard that song, I guess, when it came out, 1969 or somewhere. I remember the first King Crimson album. But you could say it's applicable for today because we do seem to be, we seem to have entered a kind of, you know, split or schizoid, or at least a state in which our ideas about what's real and what isn't and truth and falsehood have been, you know, broken up and kind of mixed and matched in strange ways. And I guess it's applicable to the two books that you're referring to. One is called Lost Knowledge of the Imagination, and that came out earlier this year. And the other book is called Dark Star Rising, Magic and Power in the Age of Trump. And you might not think books with those titles would necessarily have something connecting them, something in common. But this notion of the imagination as being not kind of substitute for reality or a way in which one can escape reality, but a way of knowing, and not only knowing reality, but of somehow, in some strange way we really don't understand, in some way actually engaging with reality, and in some, as I said, a very subtle and not easily understood way that we somehow can actually create reality in some way. And that notion of creating reality is what is center most in the other book, The Dark Star Rising, because it's about how it seems that certain kinds of what we want to call mental science or new thought or even magical kinds of practices seem to have been at work with some people, at least in the sort of milieu around Trump during his campaign and during the election. And some people even believe that in some way they were actually responsible for his victory and that they had willed him into office and they had dreamed him into becoming president. And that whole idea of willing something to take place and making a dream a reality in a very, you know, concrete way, that's the essence of this sort of positive thinking and new thought. And it's also the essence of this whole idea that imagination is a creative, a causative kind of factor. It's, again, it's not something, it rather than make believe, which is what we usually think of imagination, it's actually about make real.
You know, I'm curious then, how do you see the imagination? Is it some sort of like etheric energy? Is it some sort of unseen or unknown thing that permeates? Like, does everybody have access to the same level of imagination? Like, how would you define that exactly?
Well, I guess it's one of those things, I think, that if you try to define it explicitly, you'll start losing it. It'll start slipping through your fingers, as it were. It's one of those things, I think, that we have a kind of immediate experience of, and then we try to explicitly sort of rationally say exactly what it is, it starts to in some way dissipate. It's rather like the Christian philosopher Saint Augustine was asked, you know, well, he famously wrote, you know, what is time? If you don't ask me the question, I know the answer. But I don't know, I don't try to define imagination or say what it is as so much as what our experience of it seems to be, or what the experience of it and ideas and speculation about it of different thinkers. And sort of the central theme of the first book, Lost Knowledge of the Imagination, is precisely that, it's a cognitive activity. It's a cognitive act in some way. And there's knowledge we receive through the imagination, knowledge it provides us. And then there's also knowledge about the imagination itself. And both of these kinds of knowledge have, to a great degree, become lost, or at least sort of marginalized and put aside. And it's no surprise that process whereby that happened began with the rise of science in the early 17th century, where prior to that, the notion that imagination did have cognitive potential or cognitive capacity, you could know some things about reality through it that you couldn't know in other ways, that became jettisoned. And in the West, the focus was on the kind of knowledge that was provided, you know, solely through empirical, you know, evidence, study, you know, analysis, observation, or through reason and logic. So this other more imaginative knowledge that's associated with the Hermetic tradition, you know, the tradition of Hermeticism and Gnosticism and the Kabbalah and philosophical schools like Neoplatonism. But if you look through the history of the West, you see where this break happens and then how there's an undercurrent, a counterculture, let's say, or a subterranean kind of culture of the imagination that remains and is always there. And in the book, Lost Knowledge, I refer to the song 21st Century Schizoid Man, and that's by way of referring to a book by Ian McGilchrist, who's a neuroscientist, but also and a psychologist and also English scholar. He's someone who has sort of, well, he writes about two sides of the brain in his book, The Master and His Emissary. And to make a long story short, His contention is that, you know, over the last few centuries, the left side of the brain, which is more rational and analytic and logical and linear and so on, has gradually gained dominance and has sort of more and more marginalized the kind of experience of the world that we get through the right brain, which is it's more holistic. It's much more sort of meaningful in the sense that there's a sense of the relationship between things, which is fuzzy. It's vague, but it's felt. And it's an experience more of sort of living immediacy of being rather than the sort of utilitarian, how do I sort of learn how to control and dominate this world, which is sort of the way the left brain works. In any case, there's been an increasing split between them where the left is gaining more and more dominance. And it's the more sort of holistic, meaningful, embedded, kind of felt, visceral connection to the world that the right brain provides is being marginalized, or, you know, just basically is being lost. And that's creating a kind of split. I mean, we're already split in the sense that we have the two brains, but now it's even becoming more and more of a greater split, where the kind of society, the kind of world that's being increasingly created around us is one that's informed only by sort of left brain sort of values. And so we're creating a world that's sort of abetting this kind of cutting off, you know, a whole other half of ourselves. And that's where the lost knowledge is. This, as I said, the Hermetic tradition in the book, I refer to it as a kind of body of right brain sort of knowledge. And again, it's real knowledge. It tells us something that's real about the world, about our experience, but it isn't the kind of quantitative or measurable or proof-oriented sort of knowledge that the left brain, you know, scientific mind requires. And as we all know, that's absolutely important. And so after all of that, the idea of 21st century schizoid man relates to the other book, Dark Star Rising, is that, well, we seem to have entered this time now where the sort of stable and conventional and widely accepted view of what's reality, what constitutes reality, has been jettisoned. And we do live in a world where it's uncertain now, and it's a complete kind of, what do you want to call it? It's constantly shifting, changing world in which the meanings of things aren't stable. You know, the reality of one's identity or the whole idea of identity has become sort of unstable as well.
Yeah. So, you know, that left versus right paradigm that you were just talking about with the brain, we obviously see that that relates to politics as well. And I'm just curious if you see that sort of left and right political division as maybe a more macrocosmic example of what's going on inside all of our heads.
Well, I imagine so, that it informs that. I don't know if it's as sort of global as, you know, everyone who's on the left is basically left brain oriented and you know, and vice versa. It's more about how you could have, say, you know, people are on either side of the political spectrum, but on either side of it, they can be rather more one kind of brain oriented than the other and that kind of thing. You know, you can kind of see, you know, very rigid, a very kind of analytical, a very kind of rule-based, you know, a very kind of legalistic sort of approach to things is generally more left brain oriented, very much about order. And I guess, you know, we all need that. We all need order. We all need rules. We all need structure. But if it gets too much, it can suffocate. It can kill, you know, it can constrict too greatly and become stagnant and so on. And the other is more open and loose and free and willing to experiment. And, you know, but that danger is that, you know, you do that too much, you lose any order and becomes too chaotic and just a kind of mess and anything goes. So I would say in a very, very kind of broad way, I think and this is something I'm working on in a book that I'm working on now, you can see a kind of split in the world now, or at least the kind of split I'm thinking of is something that some people are talking about, but this is sort of over in Russia with the idea that you have the new Cold War, as it were, or the new sort of, you know, global opposition. It's not between capitalism and communism, but it's between sort of the Western hyper-liberalism, where less and less sort of, you know, structure, where anything goes and, you know, people can, you know, decide what gender they want to be or what sex they want to be or what identity they want to be, or, and a kind of market-driven, you know, consumer sort of oriented society. And then many people over in Russia, in that side of the world, they are more and more promoting and advocating a kind of, you know, traditional-based society based on traditional roles and gender roles and so on and so on and like that. And this is something that Putin has referred to in more than one speech again, it's something that I'm working on now, a follow-up to Dark Star Rising, which is, along with talking about Trump and along with talking about a variety of kinds of mental science and magic and, you know, chaos magic and things of that sort, kind of in the milieu around Trump, it's also talks about the same sort of thing happening over in Russia too. So, I mean, I think you can see it in some way, and this is how McGilchrist talks about it in his book, because it's his book reboots the whole left and right brain discussion. And he also uses this as a lens with which to look at history. And he sees in history with these different periods where one or the other may dominate, or there's a period where there's a, you know, a very creative collaboration between the two. But it does seem to be that for the last couple of centuries, we seem to be getting increasingly more of just the one side. And that in itself, he tends to see it in the sense of, okay, there's the individual psyche, then you can say this kind of historical psyche. And in this sense, he sort of follows Jung's idea that the psyche has an inbuilt kind of process where it'll kind of compensate itself for imbalances. You know, in the individual, if you have too rigid and too fixed or a conscious attitude towards something, you know, so your dream life, your unconscious will compensate for that in some way. And, you know, and if you don't get the messages, and if it really is something that's important, it'll you know, do something, you know, it'll act in a more robust and not always comfortable and welcome way, you know, it'll make something happen for the situation to change. So likewise, on a, you know, historical level, in some ways, the very crisis that's created by the overdominance of the left brain will generate a response, but it may not be necessarily a picnic. You know what I mean? The response might not be just something, you know, wonderful. It could just be, you know, like a nightmare in terms of society and that kind of thing. So yes, there's a potential for a kind of, I don't know what you want to call it, you know, a flare up or a high tension point or a kind of release of the pent up energies.
Yeah, so let's get into some of the ideas in Dark Star Rising. What is synarchy, and why did it make me angry when I read about it? You may not be able to answer that last part, but what is that term?
Well, synarchy is a sort of esoteric political system or philosophy. And the easiest way to understand it is in its difference from anarchy. Anarchy means no government. Anarchy, no overriding law or rule. And synarchy means total. You know, complete or like synthesized, you know, it's, everything is brought together under the rule. And you can see political systems in the past that have similar ideas, like sort of Plato's Republic or in Hinduism, the caste system. But it became kind of part of the esoteric counter tradition in the late 19th century. And there was an eccentric French occultist named Saint-Thérèse d'Alvédre. And he wrote about these sort of dream journeys or these sort of waking dreams or astral journeys that he took to the underground city of Agartha. Now, what is Agartha? What is that all about? Well, there's a bit of a long story behind that, and you can find some references to it in sort of earlier books. And he had come across it because he had met this strange individual who not only taught him Sanskrit, but he also taught him the ancient language of Vatan, which is the language of Agartha. And this is this underground kingdom that has, it's a vast civilization that exists, you know, in the bowels of the earth, as it were. And its ruler is known as the sort of the king of the world, the Brahmatma. And synarchy is the government that is the state of this underground world of Agartha. And it's a world in which, if you take the idea of the body politic, it's a world which literalizes that whole notion, the metaphor of the body politics. It's not a metaphor, that it's real. So the state is an organic being rather than a sort of rational structure or the social contract or an agreement between people. It's something that has an organic nature, and it's hierarchical, and everyone is in their own place and this sort of thing. And Delvedge wrote about this in this book of his, and then very soon after the book was published, he had some kind of crisis, and he got all the copies of it, and he burnt them. He destroyed them. It was something about how he felt that he should not give away the secrets of synarchy or the secrets of Agartha or something like this. Or perhaps the king of the world had caught wind of what he was doing and, you know, compelled him to retract it. But even though he burnt all copies of the books, he actually lobbied for a kind of synarchy in a political program in France in the late into the early 20th century, and it was very popular in many ways. It was very successful. It got quite a few followers, and he was able to interest many famous figures at the time, and so on and so on. But it kind of dropped out of awareness with World War One. But then it supposedly carried on a kind of secret underground existence in the years in between the wars in far right, extreme far right political circles in France, and then during the Vichy government. And I learned about it from research done by Lynn Picknett and Clive Prince in their book, The Zion Revelation, which is a fascinating book about kind of the truth behind the Priory of Zion and all that Holy Blood, Holy Grail kind of thing. But the reason they make an appearance in the book is that in this milieu in Paris in the late 19th, early 20th century, where this ideas about synarchy was sort of bubbling, the French scholar and sort of esoteric thinker René Guénon, this is sort of where he came. He first gets his sort of his way begins when he's in this milieu there, and he's recognized as the founder of traditionalism. And traditionalism is this rather austere, almost like fundamentalist kind of esoteric or spiritual path, which basically believes that in the ancient dim past, there was a fundamental revelation about existence and man's relationship between God and the cosmos. And this was the basis of all subsequent religions. Gradually over time, the sort of different religions kind of emerged from this. And within the deep center, the heart of each of the major religions, in their esoteric, which means inner, their esoteric center, there still is this revelation is still there. But Guénon believed that his history had moved from this golden age when the revelation was given down into, you know, what he borrowed from the Hindu tradition, talking about the Kali Yuga, you know, the dark age that we're in now in the modern world. Or if you think about it in the Greco-Roman tradition, it's the age of gold and the age of silver, the age of bronze, and now we're in the iron age. And this is a very dark, you know, time. You know, all spiritual awareness is gone, and it's all about material things and power and things of that sort. And he was basically, you know, wanting to wait out the end of the West. And one of the his followers who came after Guénon is this Italian esoteric thinker named Julius Evola. And he was a much more sort of active kind of character than Guénon. And where Guénon was sort of a priest, and he was happy to sort of wait out the decline of the West. In fact, he left Europe in late 20s and moved to Cairo and lived there until he died in, I think, 1951, and he converted to Islam. Evola was more eager to sort of help it on its way out, help it collapse. And he had they both had a great vehement hatred of the modern world, but Evola was much, he wanted to be more active about it. And he also had more interest directly in politics, and he had a real interest in far-right politics. And in the 1920s, he tried to ingratiate himself with Mussolini and the Italian fascism, and then when that didn't work out, he tried to do the same with National Socialism. And following World War II, he became a kind of eminence Greece, this kind of character in the background whose ideas, and he's a brilliant writer, and he's a very incisive thinker, and many of his criticisms of the West are, you know, spot on. It's his response to those that is questionable. But his ideas informed or created the sort of intellectual climate or atmosphere for a lot of neo-fascist groups coming out after World War II. And he died in the 70s, but now Evola is read. He's one of the intellectual heavyweights for the alt-right in the States. Or actually, it's not only in the States, it's around the world. It's in Europe as well, and other places, and in Russia too. And again, there are people in Russia who read Evola's works about the modern world and his political ideas and things of that sort. And yeah, so that in that atmosphere. And so you have Steve Bannon, who's no longer on the team, but at the time during Trump's campaign and then after the election, there was an article that the New York Times did about this talk he gave to a select group of very conservative churchmen at the Vatican. He was in the States, but it was via Skype. But the people, you know, listening to him or watching him were in the Vatican. And in the context of his general kind of, you know, far right and you know, nationalist, and you know, we have to fight Islamic fascism and so on, he name checked Julius Evola. And this was when I saw the Times, the New York Times mentioning Evola in the first place was strange enough. But then it's out in the open that, you know, Bannon is name checking him. For me, it was quite a remarkable thing to have someone who's at that time had the ear of the president, or the very much so, but he's informed by this esoteric thinker whose you know, political proclivities were very, very much on the extreme right.
Yeah, so you mentioned New Thought earlier, and we need to, I think, tease out the connection that that movement or philosophy has with the current U.S. president. So what is that connection between Trump and New Thought?
Well, we know that Trump is a devotee of positive thinking. He's a great fan of the book, The Power of Positive Thinking by Norman Vincent Peale. He was a friend and follower of Peale. He used to go to Peale's sermons at the Marble Collegiate Church on Fifth Avenue in New York. And Power of Positive Thinking is a sort of Christianized version of, as you say, New Thought or a mental science or creative visualization. And all of these things are based on the idea that thought by itself can make things happen. Thought is causative. Thoughts are things. As I've been saying in interviews, unlike Vegas, what happens in the mind doesn't stay there. It's projected out into the world. So what you think affects the world around you. And this is kind of the bare bones idea about it. And it has, you know, it has actually a rather prestigious pedigree. The phrase itself, New Thought, was coined by Ralph Waldo Emerson, the great American essayist and philosopher, who was the sort of the most well-known figure of what's known as the Transcendentalist school. And the Transcendentalists adopted ideas that go back to ancient Hindu beliefs and also to the ancient Hermetic beliefs of the West, were that the imagination, the mind, is at the center of reality. Consciousness is at the center of reality. Even though, you know, science tells us that hard physical things are what are really real, and, you know, we each have a little puddle of consciousness inside our skulls, but that's about it. It doesn't exist out in the world in any way itself. And this is a relatively recent way of seeing the world throughout ancient time, up until only about four centuries ago. The opposite was held to be true, that, you know, the spirit, or whatever you want to call it, the soul, the mind, in some way, was primary. And Emerson, in his way, he, you know, adopted these sorts of ideas, and also ideas coming from school of philosophy known as German idealism, which talks about them in their own way. But in one of his essays, he coins the phrase New Thought. And if you know Emerson, you know they're very sort of upbeat, pep talk, inspiring, motivational essays. He was more of an orator than a writer in that sense. But it was the whole idea of, you know, America, this is the new world. We've left the old world. We've left Europe behind. And this is, you know, fresh beginning, new start, virgin territory, you know, sky's the limit. And that kind of optimism and forward drive, combined with these ideas about the power of the mind itself, or one's own creative thought, one's own imagination, one's own power of directing the will out into the world and, you know, can make things happen. This, you know, created a very optimistic, forward-looking kind of way of seeing things. And then another very important American philosopher, psychologist, William James, who practically kind of invented academic psychology, he not only shared that Emersonian kind of upbeat sense of optimism and positive thinking, but he himself applied many of what was called at the time mind cure techniques and methods in order to deal with problems of his own. You know, he had suffered from depression, he had angina, and things of that sort. But he was so impressed by the results, not only on himself, but on people that he knew and cases that he studied, that when legislation was put forward in Massachusetts to sort of severely limit access to kind of mind cure sort of stuff, because the official medical boards considered it, you know, just fraudulent, that he lobbied against it, and he was successful. So here you have someone who's, you know, a very, very important figure in the intellectual world, and he's very open-minded. I mean, James was interested in mysticism, he was interested in spiritualism and what we call the paranormal. So, I mean, nowadays you can't do that. You'll be run out of, you know, your university place if you admitted to that kind of thing. But back then you could. And again, it's this fundamental idea that how you think will attract the kind of life, you know, what thoughts you have. And this is something that, you know, I don't know how many years ago now, but not too long ago, that book, The Secret, it was a very well-known secret, and it was packaged in a new way, and it came out and, you know, it became a bestseller, and there was a film and all that. But again, it's a similar sort of thing. And I guess it had its heyday in the late 19th, early 20th century, when you did have a series of different books and different writers. And then you had Christian Science, which is, it's related to, but it's not quite the same thing. But they're all in a general way dealing with this idea that thoughts are things, and that if you can focus intently, persistently, some desire, and again, it has to be something that can actually be achievable. It's not something, you know, some crazy thing. It has to be something that's actually quite doable. You can make it happen. And again, William James, he said, you know, he wrote about the will to believe. And in one of his essays, he says, well, if we believe we can do something, we have a better chance of actually accomplishing it than if we feel that we can't. And he says, if you think of someone who has to jump over, you know, from one cliff edge to the other, if he feels he can't do it, he's probably going to, you know, not do it. But if he believes that he can and has that kind of positive attitude towards it, that can actually affect the outcome. And basically, Norman Vincent Peale came out of a background of this sort of new thought. And he took many of the fundamental ideas of it and then gave them a kind of Christian packaging. And he talks about this process where you sort of prayerize, picturize, and actualize. And prayerize is where you constantly keep, you know, your desire, the wish, whatever it is that you want to happen in mind. And you basically talk to God about it a lot, or your deep self, or whatever agency that you're accepting that is going to help you out with your request. And then you picture it in your mind as clearly and as vividly as possible. You make a very sharp, clear HD image of the outcome. And then at some point that sinks down, you know, into your deep unconscious or to God or, you know, whatever. And you then act as if it's already happened. You act as if that which you have desired has taken place. And Peale says, lo and behold, it will. And this is a kind of philosophy, as it were, that Trump grew up with. His father was a follower of Norman Vincent Peale. They used to go to his sermons. I think he at least had two of his marriages in the church. I think Peale presided over one of them, and then his successor did later on. And if you know Trump's own self-help books, like The Art of the Deal and other ones, it's all full of the sort of positive thinking kind of thing. So you have Trump himself, a devotee, a practitioner of this sort of philosophy. And if you see him in action, you know he's always very positive thinking. It's always, you know, forward thinking. It's optimistic. Everything is the biggest, the best, the greatest, and all that. So we know that. But along with that, there's some other strange kinds of things. And the reason I sort of, what started the book itself was, if you remember, not too long after the election, there's a group called the National Policy Institute, the NPI. And that's a kind of harmless sounding name for a group that many people suspect isn't particularly harmless. It's associated with far right, you know, sort of white supremacist sensibilities and so on. And the head of NPI at the time was Richard Spencer, who's also the fellow who founded the alt-right and coined, you know, the term and so on, and is the sort of vocal representative of it. And at the beginning of this meeting, Spencer addresses the crowd and he says, "Hail Trump, hail our leader, you know. We made this happen. We dreamed this into being. You know, we willed Trump into office." And this caught the attention of a fellow named Harvey Bishop, who is a New Thought blogger who writes about New Thought. And it struck him that Spencer and his followers, whoever he meant when he said "we," were somehow using New Thought techniques in order to, you know, put Trump into office. And so, you know, from Bishop's point of view, they were using positive thinking to do something that, well, he considered wasn't particularly positive. So what's going on? So you have Trump sort of openly being an advocate of it. You have people around him supporting him. It looks like they're practicing it. At the same time, as I said, you know, the alt-right, one of their sort of ideological, you know, intelligentsia is this fellow Julius Evola, who he too, along with this kind of far-right esoteric politics, he too practiced the form of kind of mental visualization. In the 1920s, he contributed to, there was a sort of occult journal called the UR Journal in Italy. And under a pseudonym, he wrote quite a few articles about the same sort of thing, how you can make thoughts, how thoughts can make, you know, things happen. I mean, one of the things he wanted to make happen, and other people who were writing for the journal then, were somehow to invest Mussolini's fascists with more of the noble Roman, you know, virtues of the Roman warriors and all that, how successful they were at that, I guess, is debatable. And so it seemed like, you know, there's this milieu there, there's this stuff going on, and this is how, where, you know, what's called meme magic and that kind of thing steps in.
Yeah, and just a couple quick notes on Peel that I thought were interesting before we move too far away from him. He was labeled a closeted occultist and had that Christianized magic label slapped on the power of positive thinking, as you said. But he also used a lot of other occult phrasing in his work. You know, he talked a lot about vibration and the music of the spheres, which is really comes from the Hermetic thought. And then he also said this, attitudes are more important than facts. And you can see how Trump sort of embodies that statement, right?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, that's the key. That's a phrase he gets from psychologist Carl Menninger. And yes, yeah, it's like facts aren't important. It's your attitude towards those facts. And that itself goes back to the ancient Epicurean philosopher Epictetus, who said it's not things, it's what we think about things that affect us. And so some way is that you can order your mind, your inner world, because you're in control of that. You're not in control of what happens outside in the world, but you're in control of how you react to it and how you think about it. And yes, that's exactly, you know, Trump taking that and going with it. The facts don't matter. And again, it's a philosophy that is, well, it's a philosophy that this milieu of post-truth and alternative facts is very congenial to, because yes, okay, yeah, well, we're taking that idea. Now it's not just become something that some people on the margins of society are believing in order to somehow make something come true for themselves. It's something that our whole consciousness is accepting, because the way we discuss things, you know, things that before we used to not hesitate too much about to know whether they were true or not, or, you know, one thing or the other. Now everything is up for debate. You know, there are multiple facts and multiple truths, and there's just all that kind of thing. And this is where this world of positive thinking, the world in which the mind can kind of control reality or decide what's real for itself, that's where it kind of meets up with the whole postmodern world, because that's what postmodernism is about. There aren't any truths. There's no stable one reality. Everything's relative. Everything changes, and you can put things together in different ways. And so things that aren't normally necessarily associated with each other in the strange juncture of time which we've entered, they're right up against each other. And again, that too, you have the new thought, you've got the postmodern, you have the occult side of it, which is again about the difference between reality and well, the real and the unreal, and wanting to sort of loosen the kind of constraints that the scientific Aristotelian, let's say, you know, standard idea of reality has had. To the occult world has wanted to loosen that. And then you also have the whole phenomena of reality television. You've got, you know, what's the most popular thing on TV today is reality. And so for, I don't know how many decades now, we've been absolutely fascinated with watching reality on television. And it's not surprising that it's not a one-way street. So while we're putting more and more reality into television, we're putting more and more reality into the representation of reality, out of that representation, things are coming into the real world, and one of them is Trump. I mean, he was a reality TV entertainer for many, many years, you know, Apprentice and all that. He was, in a way, you can say that primed the American public for him, and also it primed him to be in the position that he's in now, where he's this, you know, the ruler. He's the boss. He can hire and fire, which he did. You know, how many people came and left while he was in office? It's absolutely dizzying. And again, what also comes into this mix is, what's the one word that characterizes Trump's presidency? First word I think most people would say is chaos. It's chaotic. You know, it's mad. It's everything, as I said, all the hiring and firing, all the changes of position, post-truths, alternate fact. Nobody knows exactly where he is, what he's doing. This is purposeful. He's doing it on purpose. If you know his books, or he talks about this, you know, he doesn't like to lay out his plan too much. He likes to keep everything sort of open. He doesn't want to be constrained. He wants to be able to make sudden decisions and all that. And as I came to understand this, and other people notice this as well, he seemed to be, in a way, he seemed to be purposely creating chaos around him. And this is very much what a great deal of what we know as chaos magic is about. And again, that's another magical occult practice or activity that's thrown into this mix. And before I get into saying what chaos magic is, but one of the things that links it to the positive thinking that Trump is engaged in, and apparently some of his followers is that it's result-based. What it wants is to have some real effect out in the real world. You know, there's some real change. There's something, it's not, you know, chaos magic emerged in the 70s in London, in the same sort of milieu that punk rock came out of, and it was this kind of DIY. And it was really tired of all the kind of Golden Dawn magic or the more spiritual sort of magic, which was more about a kind of meditative inner development, you know, where you contacted you had the knowledge and conversation of your holy guardian angel. And these guys, they were bored stiff with all that. And they wanted something that actually, I want to make stuff happen. You know, I want to make some kind of magical thing actually happen. And so they developed this whole system, you know, or non-system, this new approach, which I say it's like punk magic in the sense that you did it yourself and you made it up as you went along. And you adopted the kind of flux that the modern world seems to have, you know, found itself in, the ever-shifting, changing sort of postmodern world we're talking about. And instead of sort of traditional magic looks to this stable kind of hierarchical different levels of being and all that, the chaos magician is not into that. Everything is shifting and changing, and it's this kind of constant flow or, you know, just sort of shifting kaleidoscope of different perspectives. And as I started reading up about it, it struck me just naturally, Trump was sort of acting in many ways that, you know, the chaos magicians who were basically giving you the recipe how to do stuff, what they were saying to do, he seemed to be doing just on his own. And again, you know, get all these things start to fall into place because the way in which Richard Spencer and the alt-right and whoever was involved in it, the way in which they worked their kind of new thought, their positive thinking was through the internet. And it was through what has since become known as meme magic. And you know, I have to tell people what a meme is. It's a symbol, an image, you know, some kind of cultural unit that gets picked up and copied and, you know, people do things with it. And, you know, the thing that happened was that, you know, the Pepe the Frog started out as this innocuous kind of amphibian slacker. And he got co-opted by the far right people or just sort of internet, you know, kind of pop nihilists who just, you know, like the idea of doing things that are politically incorrect. And they started posting a lot of images of Pepe and Trump and, you know, Hillary Clinton got involved and she made a remark about the deplorables. And then suddenly there's the image of, you know, based on the film, The Expendables. And then there's images of Trump and his coterie and then Pepe the Frog is in there and all that. And the idea was somehow that by continuously, you know, posting these images, these memes of Pepe and Trump and all this kind of thing, they were charging it with this kind of magical intention, you know, the magical imagination. And through the internet, they wanted to make an effect in the real world. And what got them going about this in the first place is that these online, you know, addicts hanging out in places like 4chan, you know, they had this thread called Bane Posting, and they posted all these images from the Dark Knight Rises film and, you know, the opening scene where Bane's being transported and he's ostensibly in prison, but, you know, he's actually in control and we know what happens. You know, he makes the plane crash and all that kind of thing. People who into this kind of thing, what happened is that there was the tragic German Wings 9525 crash in the Alps, and people doing this Bane posting, they looked and they said, oh God, it looks like, you know, what happened there in that air crash, it's very much like what takes place in these scenes from the film that we've been posting. And, you know, there's all these coincidences they started seeing. You know, one was there's a town near the crash called Bane, and one of the crash investigators, his name is Bruce Robin, and Bruce Wayne is Batman's secret identity, and Robin's his sidekick, and so on. So there's other things kind of came to light and seemed to suggest more and more that there was some strange connection. And it's very much along the same lines as the Slender Man phenomenon, you know, where people were posting about Slender Man and then lo and behold, things happened in the real world. And so somebody christened this synchromysticism, meaning that, you know, when things that were happening on the internet bleed into the real world and actually make things happen in the real world. And it's kind of an internet techno online version of what the psychologist C.G. Jung called synchronicity. And that's, as we know, that's when something in the mind, something in your head, and something out in the world outside, they have a meaningful connection. There's no causal link. One didn't make the other happen. But suddenly something you were thinking about is something you dreamt about, and you see it out there, and it has this immediate, undeniable impact of there's a link between the two. So if you want to say, instead of the imagination, which we've been talking about already, and it being creative and having this capacity in some way we don't understand in order to somehow affect the world outside, if you think of the internet as an exteriorized imagination, so this is what's happening. So instead of a synchronicity between something happening in my head and the world, it's something happening between the internet and the world. And this was the whole idea that they were going to make it happen. And then all these other coincidences started turning up around it. You know, and then there's the whole phenomenon of Keck and the frog being linked to an ancient Egyptian god of chaos. And, you know, there's a lot in there. I can't go into it now. It takes too much to try and explain it. But this whole kind of atmosphere of all these strange coincidences seemed to be growing and building up around this meme magic that was being engaged in. And so the idea was, well, somehow, well, you know, does it work? You know, is it really taking place? Are we really making things happen? And so this is the whole kind of milieu around Trump, you know, with his own positive thinking and people supporting him, engaging in it in different ways. And all I can say is, well, he's actually president, so I don't know. Did they make it happen? I don't know. I mean, there's people who've taken it seriously enough, who are also occultists or work in magic, who are trying to resist. You know, there's the whole sort of witches against Trump, magical resistance that's been going on now for some time. So on that level, they're taking it seriously.
Definitely. And, you know, we're towards the end here of our time, but I do want to tease out one more thing here that I think is worth noting. And it is this idea of postmodern theater that you touch on in the book. And you're talking about this Russian, I don't know if he's a politician exactly, but Vladislav Surkov and his impact on Russian politics. And, you know, I think that would give us a better understanding of what we're looking at here, because you wrote that he ran Russia as a wonderful postmodern theater. And I mean, I do love me a good melodrama, but I do think that we should probably characterize this because it's going on in Russia, but you can also see how it's sort of bled over into the U.S. as well.
Oh, yeah. No, absolutely. Well, Vladislav Surkov was sort of Putin's PR man, or what they call the political technologist, from about 2000 to about 2013 or 14. And this was more or less at the beginning of Putin, when he pretty much began to gain kind of total control over the media, more or less, in Russia. And Surkov was able to create a kind of, well, almost like a virtual reality world for the Russia media audience to watch and to be entertained by. And it was sort of like infotainment, the news. I mean, you think in the States there's quite a bit of that, but there it was completely that, more or less, where any kind of coverage was, you know, determined or okayed and had to get the rubber stamp, basically, from the Kremlin. But to give the appearance of a democratic society, which was what Putin wanted, you know, the West or the people in Russia themselves, first off, to believe was happening, and also the West, because I think it was in the early days he was still trying to present himself as a reformer and a liberal and someone, you know, sort of bringing economic prosperity and so on, was this what Surkov called managed democracy, which was something that it was a, you know, more or less controlled society, but it had the appearance of democracy. And certain freedoms were allowed within it, you know, a great deal of freedom, actually, a lot of economic freedom and entertainment, things of that sort. But when it came down to the, you know, the fundamentals of who was running the show, I mean, that really wasn't in question. But to give the appearance, Surkov would sort of invent oppositional political parties, and then they would have a kind of debate on television, and it would be on the news broadcast, and it would reach, you know, millions of viewers and all that. But it was all scripted, and it was all determined in advance, you know, what the outcome was, and meaning that the outcome was whatever what Putin wanted it to be. So the whole idea of this kind of vital, vibrant sort of democratic process going on was basically a kind of reality TV a show. And he did this across the board, and he did this in a variety of different ways. And he himself was very much a character like this. I mean, Surkov was a very postmodern character, the whole kind of cynical sense of all truths being relative, and, you know, believing in anything is really a liability, and everything is kind of like a put on job or a joke. And he would be seen at, you know, art galleries at a fashionable sort of art show openings. And he himself wrote, or he claimed not to have written, but it's pretty sure he wrote, this satiric novel called Almost Zero, sort of satirizing the whole kind of cynical PR world that he was in. But at the same time, he was creating the world that he was satirizing. So it's all this kind of sort of self-analysis that postmodernism goes through, but with this kind of tongue-in-cheek attitude where in the end, nothing really, you know, nothing really matters and all that. And he ran the show in this way for a decade, or a little bit more than a decade. And probably the last big production of his was the events in Ukraine, with the whole idea of, East Ukraine, you know, these Russians that were there that wanted to, you know, go back and be part of Russia again, and they were being oppressed by the Ukraine fascists and so on and so on, and how these sort of freedom fighters, and this was all sort of Russian troops, but they were camouflaged, and a variety of different things that he sort of managed to give the appearance of a kind of, you know, indigenous uprising, which was really instigated by Putin and all that. So if you think about Trump as being a reality TV character, and he's bringing that sensibility of reality television to the White House and to American politics, this is something that was going on in Russia for quite some time before Trump. You know, Trump is sort of like a one-man show kind of doing it, whereas Putin was a whole kind of studio system broadcasting a variety of different things. And that's shifted in more recent times. Eventually, sort of the public became tired of this kind of faux reality that was being created for them, this kind of cynical, nothing is true and anything goes kind of, as long as you keep me entertained sort of sensibility. And this is when sort of Putin has shifted to this idea of what used to be known as Holy Russia, Russia as the bearer of the traditional values that the West have, you know, jettisoned and abandoned in its increasing sort of plunge into decadence and all that. So from being this kind of false reality created through the media world, there's been a movement towards this kind of, as I said, traditional orthodox religious sense of Russia as this new sort of civilization coming up and no longer trying to keep up with the West, no longer sort of being a backward cousin of Europe, but something completely on its own. And a lot of the ideas about that that are in the air, and that some of which have reached Putin, come from this character, Alexander Dugin.
Yeah, yeah. I don't know if we mentioned Dugin, but as you say in the book, he was hired to write for an ultra-conservative newspaper, and his job title was essentially, he was a professional conspiracy theorist, right?
Yes, exactly, yeah. Among many things. Now, he's a, you know, I mean, whatever you might think of his politics, and there's certainly enough there to question, but he has a remarkable career and this kind of, as you say, a professional conspiriologist, and even taught courses, I think, in it, and in academy of some kind. But he's someone who's combined a variety of different very radical, mostly far-right political ideas with various kinds of ideas like traditionalism, the sort of fundamentalist esoteric school, we might call it, that the Italian esotericist and far-right political thinker Julius Evola belonged to. And also things like chaos magic and a variety of other things. So he's a figure that is very much embodies the kind of strange occult politics that seem to have come up with Trump and company.
Yeah, I think the best way to describe this is a chaos magic approach to political systems, right?
It seems, well, I'm saying that that's how my sort of journey, for sake of a better word, into this strangeness started, was when he said the whole idea that somehow the alt-right was using the internet in order to get Trump into office by meme magic, you know, basically posting images and symbols on the net, and somehow through that, using the internet in order to make changes happen in the actual world. And well, that's going on, said to have gone on, and, you know, there's reports about it and so on and so on. In Russia, Dugin has been doing something similar, but on a bigger scale, and not so much about getting a particular person into office as a kind of vision of Russia to be taken seriously or to inform those in power. So it's less about, you know, getting someone in power as it is to influencing someone who already is in there. And in many ways, they're sort of very convenient for each other, because I'm sure you know Russia went through continues to go through a very turbulent sort of identity crisis ever since the collapse of the Soviet Union. Not quite sure what it means, you know, to be Russia or Russian and so on. And Dugin is very much behind this idea of what's known as Eurasia. And that's the sense, as I said already, that Russia is not sort of a backward cousin of Europe, but is a planetary civilization of its own. It takes the notion that rather than there being like one linear kind of history, that sort of from the Enlightenment, we have this notion of a sort of linear history and progress going on as time goes on and so on. The idea that civilizations, rather than progressing along this linear kind of sequential way, they sort of self-enclosed organisms that they're born, they grow, they come to maturity, and then they start to fade out and they die. And from this perspective, the West is in its like death throes, and with the kind of hyper-liberalism and globalization and everything becoming a marketplace and so on and so on. And rather than Russia taking part in that, Russia is part of this new civilization that's growing, that's called Eurasia. And this is where part of that plan is to more or less to reabsorb the territories that belonged to the Soviet Union, but also to make alliances with other countries and to form a kind of counter to the Western powers, which, I mean, Dugin sees it in terms of this eternal conflict between two fundamental sort of planetary forces. And one is what he calls the Atlanticists, which are the seafaring nations, and that's the United States and United Kingdom and NATO countries and so on. And as I said, what he calls Eurasia, and this is sort of the mother of all continents. It's the great, you know, the largest landmass on the planet, encompassing sort of Eastern Europe and over towards Asia and all that. And the way he sees it, there's this eternal conflict throughout history between these two sort of fundamental oppositions. And it's coming to a head now. And the whole idea that this was sort of floated in the early 90s, Francis Fukuyama's book, End of History, where with the collapse of the Soviet Union, the idea that Western democracy and liberal market values have now succeeded, they've won out over communism. So the history in the sense of the kind of liberal freedoms that enjoyed by Western democracies are now available to everyone. In that sense, it's come to its fulfillment. And for people like Dugin and others like him over that side of the planet, they see this, they're completely revulsed by this, because this basically means that the world is now just one huge marketplace, you know, available for Western global companies and so on and so on. And they want to kind of take a stand against that. And what they stand on is this notion of these traditional values, a kind of traditional, organic, hierarchically a structured society with traditional sex roles and gender roles and, you know, roles in the family and so on and so on. And again, this goes back historically to a sense of Russia being the embodiment of the true Christian teaching. After the fall of Rome and then the fall of Constantinople, Moscow, which had inherited the tradition of Greek Orthodox Church, became the third Rome. And it was considered the true bearer of the true faith. And this was lost with the Bolsheviks and throughout the whole Soviet period. But now there's a sense of a sort of return to that in some way, a revitalizing of this old identity of Russia.
Yeah, and I just want to share a quote here to kind of wrap up this conversation on our wonderful postmodern theater. But you had wrote that, you know, the aim of guys like Surkov was to create a postmodern dictatorship that uses language and institutions of democratic capitalism for authoritarian ends. And you also go on to say that people know it's not a true democracy, but the stability that Putin brought to a collapsed society, resulting in a much higher standard of living, compensates for the loss of freedom, and most are willing to accept this. And Gary, I gotta tell you, man, that makes me extremely sad for some reason. It's just
well,
depressing.
Yeah, I understand. I mean, this is something I gathered from different sources I was reading about this. Is that, and again, I'm not in Russia. I'm not talking to people there. So I'm doing this from sources available to everybody, you know, journalists and blogs and so on. But it seemed that many people, when asked, you know, how does it feel to be in a country that most people in the West seem as more or less totalitarian and not free, and they say, well, yeah, we understand that, but actually, things are much better than they've ever been before. I mean, I don't know if that's really the case now. I know there's conflicting ideas about Russia's economic situation and so on and so on. I mean, there's a wonderful book by a fellow named Peter Pomerantsev, which I think is called Nothing is True and Everything is Possible, or something along those lines, where he worked in media. And he was in that world of Surkov's world, the media world, where the news was just kind of invented. And a variety of, you know, different programs were just kind of created in order basically to keep people's minds off anything else other than what, you know, what they were watching on television. And he said it was just incredible what he could do, you know, the sort of leeway he had in one sense. You know, he had incredible leeway what to come up with, but in other sense, it was, you know, very strictly controlled. It had to, the message had to be a certain thing, but you had kind of a great deal of freedom in how you could get that message across. Yeah, I mean, it's the sort of thing today. I mean, you can say, yes, it isn't as bad in the West now, but are we going in that direction? And then you can sound alarmist, but that the sense that it's alarmist to think that, you know, in some way, a society is giving over its ability to think intelligently and to take critical stance on things. even if unwillingly, but still seemingly not being able to stop the process of giving it over to just constant kind of wash of entertainment in different forms. And again, it's the whole, this representation of reality that's beginning to, you know, take over from it. And one of the sort of the themes in the book I talk about is how sort of what we call reality TV and TV, you say reality TV and TV reality, that the things have kind of, there's kind of an exchange going on, you know, between what we watch on the television and what happens in real life. And, you know, for years now, what we're watching on television is real life. Reality television was the most popular thing. But I would say in the last few years, we're getting a return back from the TV itself. It's coming out of the television into the world we live in. And, you know, it's difficult at times to tell the difference. That's one of the themes of the book, too. You know, we live in a time when the partitions between reality and unreality and truth and fact and falsehood, so on, are very thin. And it's a time of great opportunity in some way, but it's also a time of, you know, great danger. And it warrants much caution, I would say.
Definitely. Yeah, I would agree with that. So last question for you, man. You know, when we first started talking about doing a show here, you know, you suggested we pair both of your recent books together because the themes overlap. And I hope the audience has picked up on that here. And obviously the one theme that ties them both together is the, I guess, the lack of human imagination. And this latter part of the chat about your Dark Star Rising book, I can't help but wonder if a lot of this magical chaos that seems to be taking place around us, I wonder if that maybe isn't a way to sort of wake up the imagination. So my last question here is, do you think this is a wake-up call to us, to our imaginations? And whether it is or it isn't, I mean, where the hell do we go from here anyways?
Well, in both books, one of the themes I end the books on is this notion of a responsibility of the imagination. And this was a phrase that comes from the philosopher of language and inkling, Owen Barfield. The inklings were this group of writers who met in Oxford, and was C.S. Lewis and Tolkien, and a fellow named Charles Williams, but also Barfield. He was their friend, and they would meet at the pub and, you know, talk about books and ideas and so on. But he wrote these wonderful books about the philosophy of language, and it was through studying language that he came to the conclusion that our consciousness has evolved over time. And that, put it very briefly, the consciousness of ancient human beings was very, very different than our own consciousness. And along with that, the world itself appeared to people at a different time, very different than it appears to us now. And this led him to understand that as our consciousness changes, actually the world, the way we perceive it and the way we experience it and understand it changes as well. And he came up with the phrase that interior is anterior, meaning that what is inside the mind is earlier than what we perceive out in the world. And this is completely against the standard scientific view, where the mind is, you know, basically a kind of mirror that just reflects whatever's out there in the world, or it's a, you know, kind of storeroom where you collect lots of stuff. But it's a one-way kind of process. Things come from outside inside, but they don't go the other way. But what Barfield is saying, and what the whole Western esoteric and Hermetic tradition and Platonic tradition and many other traditions are saying, is that no, this is not really the case. Actually, you know, how we, what we experience in our inner world, how we think and how we imagine, actually has an effect out there in the world. Now, before we start thinking, oh, you know, does that mean if I imagine whatever, my couch turning into gold, it'll turn into gold? No, of course, that's not what we mean. But in some way, we don't understand our own consciousness is unconsciously, because we don't do this voluntarily, is somehow intimately involved in the world that we perceive outside us. And so I think, yes, this is a wake-up call, imagination, and I think it's a wake-up call to the responsibility for the imagination. Because I think because the West has lived under, or imagination has, put it this way, has been sort of marginalized or kind of given a sort of second-class citizen status since the rise of science and rationalism and the Enlightenment and all that, and from which we obviously gathered much good and many benefits. But in kind of a response or reaction to the marginalization, there's a tendency to sort of go the other direction, you know, go completely all out, let the imagination rip, you know, just let it, whatever, just let it complete freedom and no impression and no inhibition about it whatsoever. And Barfield and other people like Henri Corbin, who is the great scholar of Persian mysticism, and people like Jung and many others, they've all, throughout history, and I've written about them in this book and others, they all caution that that too is insufficient or inadequate or carries dangers, like letting the imagination just sort of explode without any kind of guidelines is not good either. And so the idea is to develop a kind of system where you understand it, because the imagination, again, it's not just anything goes. That's the problem. It's one of the distinctions I make in the book between true imagination and fantasy. Or I would say, you know, postmodernism is mostly fantasy in the sense that it just puts things together that already exist. It doesn't really create anything new. It just kind of takes things in different ways and puts them together. Much like mentioned earlier, someone like Dugin puts together a kind of ideological kind of a Lego block. You just kind of, let's take a bit of this, bit of this, bit of this, and throw it together and see what happens. And so true imagination is something that goes deeper into the origin of things. And that's why it's original, not in the sense of being novel or strange. You know, it's original because it goes deep into the origin. And I think, yes, we need to understand that. And we need to understand that, you know, unlike Vegas, you know, what happens in the mind doesn't always stay there. You know, it goes out into the world. And this isn't to become paranoid and, you know, sort of afraid of what we think, but it's to understand that our minds are active. What we have inside our head is an active ingredient of the world outside us. And so if some people take that very seriously and sort of do this intentionally, you know, we should be aware that that's happening and act accordingly.
Definitely, man. Could not agree with you more. I think that's a good spot to wrap up here. I do appreciate you taking as much time as you did here.
My pleasure.
To talk through this with us. Yeah, and please do tell the people where they can find both Lost Knowledge of the Imagination and Dark Star Rising if they're interested.
Well, they can find it at, you know, all your good bookshops. So it's on Amazon. You can get information about the books at my blog. That's garylockman.co.uk. I'm on Facebook, Twitter. So if you're interested, drop me a line.
Cool, man. All right. Well, Gary, again, thank you for your time. Much appreciated.
My pleasure.
Good luck with the books, and I'll talk to you soon.
Take care. Bye-bye now.
And there you have it. My thanks again to Gary Lockman for swinging by this house party. He's been making the rounds on the podcast circuit recently, and it was so nice for him to make my humble abode one of his destinations. I really do wish I could have gotten more time with Gary, but we had some technical issues during the chat that cut this one down a bit shorter than I would have liked. And with that comes a lot of unanswered questions from my notes on his two books, both of which are worth picking up. We barely scratched the surface on the first book, Lost Knowledge of the Imagination, and of the two, believe it or not, that was the one I enjoyed the most. So I may see if Gary wants to come back sometime in the next couple months and take a deeper dive into that lost knowledge. Of course, his Dark Star Rising book is making all sorts of headlines across the internet, no surprise based on the political nature of it. Gary told me he was also being interviewed on RT, of all places, about this book. Not sure if he's done that yet. And the thing that struck me the most about this book was the amount of context and character given to that postmodern theater that emerged in Russia over the course of the last couple decades, and how, if you just sit back without any preconceived ideas or biases, how you can see it also playing out right here in the US right now. We are living in, as Gordon White called it back in episode 66, an engineered spectacle, or as I call it, a pro wrestling reality. Anyway, some shoutouts are in order to some new patrons. We had a hell of a week actually on Patreon. My thanks to Corin, Horatio, Sean, Eric, Enoch, Emma, and Haley. They all jumped on board. And so did Greg Kaminsky, the guest in our last episode. That was quite a nice gesture from Greg. Thank you so much for that support. And a huge thank you to Corey, who also joined the Patreon and became an official executive producer of the show. Welcome to each and every one of you. You can join these fine folks in helping support this esoteric endeavor of mine by clicking on through to patreon.com/occulture. 4 levels of support, $2, $5, $10, and $20, and I actually just added a new reward for $10 and $20 patrons. I call it Occulture Picture Show, and it's essentially a long-distance movie night enabled by, well, by one of two websites that I'm looking at using. One is called letsgaze.com, that's letsgaze.com, and the other is called Rabbit, rabb.it. Both allow you to watch things together via computer and also have microphone and webcam functionality built in so we can literally talk and see each other as we watch along together. So $10 and $20 patrons, you now have access to that reward. So be on the lookout for more information on when we'll be doing that for the first time. And whenever we do it, you will be the ones to decide what we watch together. I think that's a pretty cool reward, and I'm really looking forward to doing this one actually. I also need to get some more raw episodes out for the $5 and up patrons, and I'm going to try to get a couple scheduled soon, but time, man, Time sure is becoming harder to come by these days. But hey, them's the breaks. Them is the breaks. Well, that's it for me this time around. Until next time, you've just been initiated into woke culture. I am Ryan Peverly, reminding you to love yourself, think for yourself, and question authority.
This cassette.